Welcome to Around and Aside, a diplomatic journey. ഇന്നത്തെ പ്രത്യേക സാഹചര്യത്തിൽ ഇന്ത്യയുടെ ഭാവിയെപ്പറ്റിയുള്ള ചർച്ചകൾ വളരെയധികം നടക്കുന്ന സമയമാണ്. നമ്മുടെ മുൻ പ്രസിഡൻ്റ് ശ്രീ അബ്ദുൽ കലാം പറയുകയുണ്ടായി, ഇന്ത്യ 2020 ഒരു വികസിത രാജ്യമാകുമെന്ന്. അപ്പോൾ അദ്ദേഹത്തോട് പലരും ചോദിച്ചു, ശരിയാണോ, നടക്കുമോ എന്ന് ചോദിച്ചപ്പോൾ അദ്ദേഹത്തിൻ്റെ മറുപടി, അതൊരു സ്വപ്നമാണ്, ജനങ്ങൾക്ക് ഒരു ഉദ്ദേശം വേണം, ഒരു ഒബ്ജക്റ്റീവ് വേണം. അപ്പോൾ 2020 ആയില്ലെങ്കിൽ പോലും ആകണമെന്നുള്ള നമുക്ക് ആഗ്രഹം, അത് നടന്നില്ലെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് മറ്റൊരു വർഷത്തേക്ക് നീങ്ങാം. അങ്ങനെ ഇപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ 2047 നമ്മുടെ പ്രധാനമന്ത്രി ഇന്ത്യ വികസിതമാകുന്ന ഒരു വികസിത് ഭാരതമാകുന്നത് 2047 എന്നാണ്. ഇതുകൊണ്ട് ധാരാളം ചർച്ചകൾ നടക്കുകയാണ്, ധാരാളം പുസ്തകങ്ങൾ. ഈസ് ദിസ് ഇന്ത്യാസ് മോമെൻറ്റ്? ഹാസ് ദേർ സം അഡ്വാൻറ്റേജ് ഫോർ ഇന്ത്യ ടു ബിക്കം എ ഡെവലപ്ഡ് കൺട്രി എന്നുള്ള ചോദ്യം. ആ ചോദ്യം ഉന്നയിച്ചിരിക്കുന്ന ഒരു പുസ്തകം, ഇന്ത്യാസ് മോമെൻറ്റ്, അംബാസഡർ മോഹൻ കുമാറിൻ്റെ പുസ്തകമാണ് നമ്മളുടെ ഇന്നത്തെ ചർച്ചാ വിഷയം. ഇൻ ടുഡേയ്സ് ഗ്ലോബ് ടോക്ക് വി ഹാവ് എ ബുക്ക് ചാറ്റ് വിത്ത് അംബാസഡർ മോഹൻ കുമാർ, ഹൂസ് ന്യൂ ബുക്ക് ഇന്ത്യാസ് മോമെൻറ്റ് ഈസ് മേക്കിംഗ് വേവ്സ് ഇൻ ഡിപ്ലോമാറ്റിക് ആൻഡ് പൊളിറ്റിക്കൽ സർക്കിൾസ്. Ambassador Mohan Kumar has had a wide experience in multilateral diplomacy, not only in trade matters in Geneva, but also the negotiations on climate change in Paris, where he was ambassador. His books have been receiving attention, and this book particularly, as it has come at a critical time in our history, just before the elections, has attracted even more attention. Welcome, Mohan. When I heard the title of the book, I had a different impression about the book, and title was a little bit misleading, I thought. But having read the book thoroughly, I know that this is much more than what the title indicates. It is virtually a textbook for the future multilateral diplomats. I do not think that we use the poverty argument at the time when I was in the United Nations. Perhaps it came up first when Mrs. Gandhi in 1972 said that poverty is the worst polluter. And from then onwards, this became an aspect. But in the earlier period in the United Nations, we did not think of the Gandhi litmus test that you are talking about or the poverty veto. These are new to me.
I'm really surprised to hear you say that poverty veto did not figure that prominently. Maybe it was an unsaid assumption. For me, the starting point was trade negotiations, where I think the poverty veto played a very important role. There's no question about it. In the Uruguay round and thereon, it played an extremely important role. But to move on to climate change, I will readily concede to you that climate negotiations have changed. There is no question about it. It has changed substantially. We took a position, which I thought was well justified in the beginning, that we will do nothing because we were not responsible for anything in terms of emissions. So we pointed a finger at the developed countries and said, please do something. The obligation is entirely yours, not shared by us.
We use the word main responsibility of the developed world. You know, later became the new formula of common but differentiated responsibility.
Yes, but sir, I don't want to nitpick. I remember having a detailed discussion with the late Ambassador Chandrasekhar Das Gupta, and it's a great pity he died before the release of my book, because I drew heavily on my personal conversations with him. And he rightly pointed out to me the background for this common but differentiated responsibility, which I've traced in my book. In retrospect, even he agreed, I wish we had stuck to the word main responsibility, because there's a difference between main responsibility and common responsibility.
Yes, but we fought over it for weeks together. It was not conceded like that.
Correct. Now, by saying common responsibility, our position that we will have no responsibility for this issue because it's all the fault of the developed countries, that argument became difficult to sustain, frankly, because it's a common responsibility.
Yes.
A common responsibility means developed countries have their responsibility, but India also has its responsibility. The only thing is there is a differentiated responsibility. Nobody is arguing that India must have the same level of responsibility as the United States. But India cannot say we have absolutely no responsibility because the issue was caused by you. I think that is where things changed. In a multilateral context, there are two things at stake. One, your own national interest, which I have tried to portray as poverty veto and the rest of the criteria which we can discuss. Second, your ability to garner support. And especially in the WTO, we were left standing alone, no question, in the Uruguay round. In climate change, it's very interesting. The G77 and the basic coalition was a bit at loggerheads. And this is a point made by several people. A lot of people said by joining the basic coalition, which is Brazil, China, India, South Africa, we were actually moving away a little bit from the G77. The G77 itself got split because the small island nations, and this is the Alliance of Small Island States, actually started pointing a finger at India along with China by saying that, listen, India also is responsible because some of us may not exist if India continues at this pace. I think China, I make this point in my book, that China very intelligently hid behind India.
What happened in Copenhagen was tragic to a certain extent, because I got the feeling at that time that the Chinese and the United States had colluded with each other to change the situation in Copenhagen. I think India joined it with great difficulty. And as you know, the developing countries walked out of the conference when this was announced. How can you say it's all voluntary in a situation where the culprits are visible and they are escaping the responsibility?
The perception is not wrong, but you have to take into account that there are two major wars going on in the world. There is a complete failure of multilateralism. The only thing working in the entire UN system is the climate change negotiations. Everything else has failed. The UN Security Council is moribund. Less said about other UN agencies, the better. But the only negotiation which is showing, as you to use your words, memorable words, incremental progress, insufficient as it is, and I take all your criticism, we are not doing enough. There is only one planet we have, and the climate change is much more threatening than the kind of solutions we are able to offer to combat it. All that is valid. But I put it to you that the only wing of the UN is the UNFCCC. Everything else has completely collapsed.
Permanent member fights a war. I mean, that is the crucial point.
There were only two enforceable mechanisms in the multilateral system. One was if there is a unanimous resolution of the UN Security Council, and you know this better than anybody else, then it is binding on all members of the UN, and so it's enforceable. Second, we used to be very proud, those of us who negotiated in the WTO, that we've got an enforceable dispute settlement mechanism. And it used to be described as the jewel in the crown of the WTO, the dispute settlement mechanism. It's a very small Pacific nation, as you know, and they won against the United States in a WTO award. But today, thanks to the United States, the WTO dispute settlement mechanism is finished. So there is no enforceability now in any forum, let alone climate change. So that is part of the terminal decline of multilateralism that I'm talking about.
I think the final solution or the final salvation for the world would be something of a technological solution. This is what I feel. Yeah. And another point is about India's own position in the UN. You are a little bit negative about what we were doing in the initial stages. Do you know that from 1947 to 1962, India was the most popular country in the United Nations because of decolonization, because of apartheid, the kind of things that we took there, regardless of Article 2 of the UN Charter, had given us a very good profile. In fact, several assessments said after the permanent five, India is the most active. But now we tend to say, oh, we were keeping out of all this, we were the on the shore looking at the sea, you must jump into the sea, etc. Fine. But I think we really played a big role. After 62 is a different story because, you know, we were, our weaknesses were exposed.
I completely agree with you. My theory, argument is that whatever you said was 100% true. You know, we were really the Vishwaguru at that time. That's what you're trying to tell me in the UN, where everybody came to you for advice, etc. The question that was being asked, and I'm not saying one view is right and the other is wrong. I'm merely trying to tell you how the view shifted. I think the view shifted because of three things. One, people started asking, how did all of this help you? Because then by 2005, 2010, we should have become a member of the Security Council. That did not happen. Second, how did it help you in Kashmir? It did not. Because by then, if we were that powerful and held in high esteem, even if we had soft power and not hard power, then country should have taken a decision that, listen, when it comes to Kashmir, slightly be more realistic. You can't really hold this against India. That did not happen. Third, in terms of actual negotiations in the WTO in particular and climate change, we discussed earlier, there was no support for India among a large number of G77 countries. In the WTO, most certainly not. We were left with five countries, Venezuela, Cuba, Dominican Republic, and I will not embarrass you anymore, really. Everybody else deserted us. In climate change, the smaller countries and OPEC countries, as you rightly point out, left. So the questions were asked of Indian foreign policy, and you can't really blame them for asking it. They said, listen, we've spent so much money, so much time, so much effort in trying to build this non-aligned movement, G77. The question has to be asked by people and were asked by people, what did India get in return? I think you may not agree with my argument, but I think nobody can deny that India's foreign policy in the past had a strong idealistic streak. Today, it has a strong real politics streak.
We make these divisions, idealistic Nehru's time and pragmatic during Mrs. Gandhi's time, globalized during Narasimha Rao's time, and so on. No, so this can be divided like that. But in all this, I think our basic approach was Pandit Nehru's. He said, we will fight for our country, our possession. But whatever we do will also be for the good of the world. And so we're not disappointed when Indian soldiers were killed in a peacekeeping operation. Nobody in India protested. Why are you sending these people? So that global thing that we are talking about it now, it has always existed in our policy. We did everything on a point of a principle and also practicality in the more recent past. And climate change, our image has changed completely because we are willing to do things for ourselves. Of course, if international cooperation comes well and good, otherwise we'll find our other ways. And that, of course, is a very, very good position. And on the Security Council membership, you know the complications. That'll never happen because a privileged group is not going to give up their power at any time. So I'm not at all optimistic that such a thing will happen. I don't expect that. And we should not expect that, I think.
If I may switch the role for a minute, I know you are questioning me and I have no right to question you, but we go back a long way. If you allow me this prerogative, if there is one thing you would have done differently about the Indian campaign for a membership of the Security Council, permanent membership, what is that one thing that you would have done differently, sir?
I had said that we had to do three things to qualify for this. You should sign the NPT, not acceptable, okay. Right? Okay. You have to settle with China, right? You have to settle with Pakistan. If you do these three things, then our chance, these are the things which are held against us.
Do you really think these things could have helped us become a member? Or they would have said, they would have still said we are a club, why allow this?
But our membership does not depend only on permanent members. You need two-thirds majority, which we don't have.
So
the two-thirds majority would like to throw these people out, the five of them, than take a sixth or the seventh. That is the real situation.
No, my question is, if whatever you said was right, and please don't take it the wrong way, you know, all the things we did in the UN, and you have pointed to so many things we did. Why did we not, or why are we not confident of getting two-thirds membership?
No, that is because of the psychology of the UN. The General Assembly, what do they get by India, Japan or Germany becoming permanent members? We look after our own interests like the other P5. So they get nothing. If you expand the non-permanent members, at least Antigua and Barbuda will one day be a member of the Security Council. This is their approach. It is a different argument than what we have. What they are saying is, as a democratic organization, we should have no vetoes. So every year, as you know, there is a resolution adopted by the General Assembly to abolish the veto. But nobody cares about it. So
I see.
So the general feeling in the General Assembly is that expansion of permanent membership is not the answer. And that is why the coffee group and all that, which Pakistan needs, Italians do.
United so, for coffee. Or United.
So this is something which we should not pursue. This will happen only if you have a new United Nations.
That's a very interesting what you say. And it's a shame because a lot of us grew up studying international relations, and the United Nations was the epitome of multilateral cooperation. There was a lot of idealism, and a lot of people said that the United Nations.
We trust the UN more than the UN does. I see that you are looking at our Ukraine policy very positively, don't you? Because we have.
I look at it very positively, and exactly. Since you raised the issue of Ukraine and G20, I have cited these two examples to basically make the point that India finds itself in a geopolitical sweet spot. And especially in Ukraine, I have made the point that the government has implemented the Honorable External Affairs Minister's mantra, which he wrote in his first book, not the current book, but the previous book.
That's the Ramayana
India
book.
Way, the India Way, correct. Where he says that India's process of multi-alignment or a foreign policy based on multi-alignment should be to actually engage the United States, cultivate European Union, bring Japan into play, reassure Russia, and manage China.
That's a perfect formula.
Correct. I believe that in the case of Ukraine, I'm not saying in every case we can do it, but in the case of Ukraine, I believe India has succeeded in implementing this mantra in full. And if you read my book, it was not easy to retain the fundamental basis of your defense relationship with Russia and maintain your strategic partnership with the United States and Europe.
But China factor is very important in this, because
absolutely.
Even in G20, the defector or the one who did not join us was China, for obvious reasons. And this global South, China would see it as a threat to itself.
Absolutely. I think China, there are voices in China which said, why have you not invited us for the Voice of the Global South Summit, which we did twice online. And they see themselves. I have said elsewhere that China does not belong to the Global South. And I have used an economic indication. And I would be perfectly happy if India reached a per capita income of $10,000. I would make the same point in order to maintain and be consistent in my approach that India should also exit the Global South. We are not anywhere near per capita 10,000. But China is not, if you use economic criteria to define the Global South, and there is no other way to define it, you can't use geographical indications, you can't, geographical rather criteria, you can't use social criteria. The only criteria you can use to define a country as belonging to the Global South has to be economic. And if you use those economic criteria, I make the point that China does not belong to the Global South. China may want leadership of the Global South. That's different. As long as the Global South agrees that we are happy to have a leader who does not belong to us, that's different.
No, that is why they are pursuing the BRICS route. Their idea is to develop BRICS into a Global South, with Russia and China in. After G20, if you look at the global reaction to India, don't you see a little bit of suspicion?
I don't know if suspicion is the right word. My assessment is there is a lot of jealousy.
Envy. I was going to say that.
There is a lot of jealousy, even from the countries of the Global South, that India is getting away with it.
Absolutely.
Now, what do I mean
this
by
is my
India
worry.
getting away with it? When I say India getting away with it, India has an extremely important relationship with the United States. We have a wonderful strategic partnership with France. We are doing an FTA with EU, with Russia. Dr. Jaishankar goes, he is received by Putin. Putin doesn't normally receive foreign ministers. The only sore point or eyesore is China. Otherwise, we have such a wonderful relationship with everybody else. I think the fact that we've done so successfully in maintaining our strategic partnerships with major countries definitely is a source of jealousy. But I'm not sure they view us with suspicion. I think India is viewed as a country. The process of multi-alignment that we have followed, I think, is bearing success for the present. Now, I am not ruling out some events in the future when we will be forced to pick sides. Ukraine was one such event where actually we were under pressure to pick a side. And you know which side we were under pressure to pick. We did not. We refrained from picking a
and
side.
Next,
of course, we condemned
be,
the
and
actions.
And next will be Taiwan, where you'll have to make a choice.
You have read my mind. Now, if something like that were to happen, it would be far more difficult for India to keep sitting on the fence and to say that, listen, we will manage this by really talking to both sides. It will be more difficult, but I am now discussing hypotheticals, frankly. I think in Ukraine, we have managed to come out unscathed, and that is full credit to the Indian government and the foreign ministry, because we also had 20,000 students stuck. I cite the other point in my integrated assessment framework, which is domestic politics.
It has been very educative for me. I'm sure my audience would also appreciate that. Thank you, Mohan, for taking off your time for this conversation. Thank you very
Khan,
much.
Thank you enough for having me, sir. Thank you.
Today's Laughtitude, I wanted to take an anecdote from Ambassador Mohan Kumar's book. There are not too many witty anecdotes in that, but there is one which is very interesting. It seems when Mrs. Gandhi was Prime Minister and she went to Moscow, there was a joint statement during the Vietnam War. And the joint statement, India and Soviet Union together, demanded a stopping of the bombing in Vietnam and withdrawal of US troops. President Johnson was very angry. He stopped the shipping of wheat under PL-480 to India. Serious matter, because that was the time when we were depending on wheat from the United States. Then the ambassador in the US ambassador in India tried to tell President Johnson that what Mrs. Gandhi was saying was not very different from what the Secretary General of the UN was saying and what the Pope was saying. She's not saying anything different. So why are you so angry with India? Then he said, but the Pope and the Secretary General does not need our wheat. ഇന്നത്തെ എറൗണ്ട് ആൻഡ് എസൈഡ് ഇവിടെ അവസാനിക്കുന്നു. നമുക്ക് വീണ്ടും കാണാം അടുത്തയാഴ്ച ഇതേ സമയം. നമസ്കാരം.